Greetings to you, our wonderful viewers, and I am particularly delighted to welcome you once again to another episode of Women on the Watch, powered by the Shapers Arc. I'm Wonuola Adetayo, and I thank you for sharing your time with us today. Our aim at Women on the Watch is to continually expose time-tested principles for practical application in your personal and relationship development matters. On this development journey, we are happy to continue to share with you valuable insights, and our prayer is that you find the lessons inspiring on your journey to excellence. Today's episode, we want to delve into the subject of change. As we all know, change is a constant in life. Yet, many times, when change comes, it catches us unawares, and sometimes we act in ways and manners in which we do not become the beneficiaries of the change. But before we start off, let us take our Bible reading. Our Bible reading is taken from Isaiah chapter 43 and verse 19. Isaiah 43, verse 19, King James Version. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall ye not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we are grateful to you once again, just for the sheer privilege to be alive. We are grateful, Lord, for the opportunity to study your word. The entrance of your word gives light, and it gives understanding unto the simple. We pray, O God, that as we go through the pages of your word, that you will enlighten our understanding, and that you will prepare us, Lord God of glory, to be positive beneficiaries of change, and also to be catalysts of change, in the mighty name of Jesus, so that we will continually advance your kingdom, even on this earth, in the mighty name of Jesus. Thank you, Abba Father. At the end, we'll be careful to return all the glory, all the honor, and all the adoration to you. And Father, please, let us be partakers of your blessings. In Jesus' name we pray, amen and amen and amen. Our story for today is the case study of Naomi and Ruth according to the entire book of Ruth. At a time of famine in Israel, there was a woman called Naomi. Her husband Elimelech and their two sons Mahlon and Chilion, faced with scarcity of food in their hometown of Bethlehem of Judah, they sought refuge in the land of Moab. While in Moab, tragedy struck Naomi's family. Her husband passed away, leaving her to become a widow. And again, her two sons had married Moabitish women named Orpah and Ruth. However, their happiness was short-lived, as both sons also died, leaving Naomi heartbroken and alone with two young daughters-in-law. Hearing the news that the famine had ended in Bethlehem, Judah, Naomi decided to return home. Naomi urged her daughters-in-law to remain in Moab in order to find new husbands and rebuild their lives. Orpah tearfully agreed and bade farewell to Naomi. But Ruth clung to Naomi. Ruth's devotion to Naomi was unwavering. She declared, "Where you go, I will go. Where you stay, I will stay. Your people shall be my people, and your God, my God." Her deep love and loyalty touched Naomi's heart, and the two of them set out on the journey back to Bethlehem together. Upon arrival, Naomi and Ruth faced all manners of uncertainties. With no source of income, Ruth decided to take it upon herself to gather leftover grains from the fields in the harvest season. In a remarkable twist of fate, Ruth ended up gleaning in the fields owned by a man named Boaz, who turned out to be a relative of Naomi. Boaz noticed Ruth's dedication and made efforts to protect and provide for her, even when he did not know who she was. Boaz let Ruth glean more and instructed his workers to intentionally leave grain for her to collect. Ruth was grateful for Boaz's generosity and shared the news with Naomi. Naomi recognized Boaz's kindness as a sign of God's favor. She encouraged Ruth to continue working in Boaz's fields, knowing that he could be their kinsman redeemer, a relative who could provide security, support, and a future for them. Embracing Naomi's guidance, Ruth followed her advice to the letter. Eventually, through a legal and cultural process, Boaz fulfilled the role of kinsman redeemer. Boaz married Ruth, bringing joy and restoration to both women's lives. Ruth gave birth to a son named Obed, who became the grandfather of King David. This remarkable lineage ultimately led to the birth of Jesus Christ, making Ruth a crucial part of the genealogy of the Messiah. It is our heartfelt prayer that each and every one of us will find grace, like Ruth and Naomi, to respond positively to unpleasant situations in order to catalyze the positive new beginnings for our lives, in the mighty name of Jesus.
It has been said that the only thing that is constant is change. Yet, most people naturally resist change instead of preparing for it and profiting from it. The Indomitable by Wanuola Adetayo offers a time-tested framework that will help you ride the waves of change in today's world that is characterized by volatility, uncertainty, complexity, and ambiguity. With scriptural evidence and research-backed facts, the book will equip you with the mental infrastructure that will help you overcome primordial instincts and respond from a place of power every time you are confronted with the realities of our constantly changing world. Give yourself an unfair advantage by imbibing sound wisdom that will help you stay ahead of the curve. Send a WhatsApp message or call 0812-402-0538 to order your copies today.
Welcome back. The story of Naomi and Ruth illustrates to each and every one of us the power that comes with embracing change, whether the change is positive or negative. Naomi and her husband had left everything that they knew behind. Why? Because they wanted a better change for their lives. Unfortunately, they were moving into the land of the unknown. And when they did, things changed negatively. Naomi now had to adapt to being a widow, then to being a mother-in-law, and then she became what? A bereaved mother. So not only just was she bereaved as a widow, she ended up to become a bereaved mother. But all of this paled in significance compared to Naomi's decision to return to Bethlehem, Judah. Ruth's decision to follow her mother-in-law also into an unknown future shows that these two women are an epitome of how we should respond to change, whether they come in a positive circumstance or a negative circumstance. Many things had plagued Naomi's mind. She must have been thinking, what about the shame when she will now appear at Bethlehem, Judah, where things had now turned around for good? Meanwhile, her own fortunes had turned bad. And then with the burden of a daughter-in-law, that she had no idea, how am I going to take care of this woman? No wonder she declared in Ruth chapter 1, verse 20, and she said unto them, call me not Naomi, call me Mara, for the Almighty had dealt very bitterly with me. That's in Ruth chapter 1, verse 20. The beauty of their entire story is that Naomi remained undeterred. In spite of the pain, in spite of the shame, she was willing to chart a new course. Ruth also was willing to adopt to a culture that she did not know, to adopt to a future that she was unsure about. She had what you might call a fearless embrace of change, even in a critical circumstance. So these two women, they had shown us that there is a positive attitude that we can bring to change, that when we embrace change positively, somehow God will always come to our aid. And no wonder these two women, they became a part of the redemptive plan of our Lord Jesus Christ. What a rich reward for their positive attitude to change. So, in today's episode that is titled Embracing Change, we will look at just two things. One, we look at the definition of change. And then second, we will look at the five possible postures to change. And we will support this with some biblical examples. So what exactly is change? What is change? If you look at the Webster's dictionary defines change as what? Undergoing transformation, undergoing transition, and sometimes undergoing substitution. That's the way the Webster's dictionary would define change. However, let us look at scripture. Scripture would define change as making something different or altering something from one state to another. For example, Abraham's name was changed from Abram to Abraham. So that is an altering of something or altering of name or of status. You will also discover that Sarai had her name changed to Sarah. Even Jacob has his name changed to Israel. So this is a change from one something altering or becoming different from one situation to another. Then we will also look at Saul and David. They experienced changes that took them from the backside of life to prominence. David was just almost the youngest boy in his family. He was in the backside of the desert, and he was called and anointed to become king. Saul was also a completely unknown person, but when change came to him, he was called and he began to prophesy, and he was anointed as king over Israel. Now, life is a cycle of seasons and times, according to Daniel chapter 2, verse 21, and also Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verses 1 to 8. So life is filled with changes. We cannot avoid change at all. What is change? Change is an inevitable cycle of life. You know, we move from birth, then we move to childhood. From childhood, we move to adolescence. From adolescence, we move to old age, and ultimately, we die. That is life, cycles of changes. Even we move from newly married to having full nest when all the children are there, and then suddenly we start having emptiness when the children start leaving, and ultimately we go back to complete emptiness, husband and wife. Now, change can be positive, like in the case of Esther. She moved from being a slave girl, a virgin, to becoming a queen. Change can also be negative. Vashti, she moved from being queen to a deposed queen. All of these stories can be read in Esther, the whole of chapter 2. Okay? So, since change is not avoidable, you can't avoid it in life. Therefore, our success in life may completely depend on our ability to navigate change. Naomi had to navigate change. Ruth had to navigate change. Saul had to navigate change. David had to navigate change. Now, we want to look at five possible postures to change. So we're looking at five change postures. And the first change posture we will look at is the unaware. Those that are completely ignorant of changes. It's a change posture. They're just there. Life is going and they are not even noticing anything. The second is the peacock. Those are the ones that are pretending that don't worry, this change, is it not us? We have been here in like forever. This thing can never change, you know? So they are the peacock attitude to change. Then we have the early adopter, those who speedily embrace change, just like Naomi and Ruth. Then we have the late adopters. They are slow to embrace change, but eventually they will come around and embrace change. And then the last one, the innovators, they are the ones that are constantly creating and pursuing change. So we look at each one of them and we will look at scripture examples. So we look at change posture number one, and that is the unaware. These individuals can be likened to those who navigate life oblivious of unfolding developments around them. Bible refers to them as the unaware. In fact, people say they call them see no evil, hear no evil, speak no evil. Biblical example of the unaware is Lot's wife. Number one, she failed to perceive or respond to the prevalent immorality in Sodom. She just pretended as if that's their own wahala, at least in my own house, everything, you know. She just ignored what was going on. Second, she did not take seriously when the angel gave them a warning. Hey, Madam, Oga, do not look back. As I am pulling you out, Sodom and Gomorrah is going into destruction. Just keep going. To her, it meant nothing. She was oblivious. And what did that create? The unaware, they often pay very dearly. Why? Because of their inattentive attention, their inattentive change posture always puts them in trouble. That is why you will see that Lot's wife ended up becoming a pillar of salt. We are told in Proverbs chapter 27, verse 12. Proverbs 27, verse 12 says, a prudent man foreseeth the evil and hideth himself, but the simple, they pass on and are punished, you know? So she was punished for her change posture. Individuals, organizations, because this thing is not just a person. It can happen to an individual. It can happen to an organization. It can even happen to a family. If they fall into this category of the unaware, it means they are not noticing changes around them and they are not, you know, doing what they need to do, either to maximize the benefit of the change or to protect themselves from the benefit of the change, as in the case of Lot's wife. Many companies have lost their businesses. Many have lost their market shares. Why? Because they ignore critical development. The same thing, even churches lose their congregation when they ignore the changes around them, the changing needs of the people, the changing needs of the members. Individual families, they also lose their relevance when they ignore critical developments around them. My prayer for you and for me is that none of us, our family members, our businesses, our churches, will be a part of the unaware, that God will open our eyes of understanding to know what we should do per time. Now, we want to look at the second change posture, and that is the change posture that we call peacocks. The peacocks, they represent those who are living in what? Denial. When you tell them that change is happening, they will say, we were here when they started this business. Nothing is ever going to happen. Why? They resist change. What do they do? They defend the status quo. They never want anything, you know. They even do not recognize the fact that God is a God of principles. As long as you are using scriptural principles and methods, he is still the author of change. Okay, so Saul, for example, exhibited this behavior. He adamantly refused to face the reality that the kingdom had been taken away from him. He told Samuel, honor me before the people. And then he began to pursue David, knowing that David has now been anointed king because he had been told, you have been replaced. Instead of acknowledging that, appeasing God to help him, or to say, okay, you know what? Let me finish this thing. Well, no. He ignored it. He was rejected by God, yet as a peacock, he wanted to continue behaving as if he was still, you know, the one in charge. He didn't make any attempt to go to God and face the reality that God had been rejected. Please have mercy on me. Pharaoh is another example, a proverbial peacock. He stubbornly refused to let Israel go despite all the plagues that God was using to show him, hey, oh boy, I'm still in charge. Yet he said, no, I will not let Israel go. Even after they have left, this peacock of Pharaoh began to pursue, until he ended up in a Waterloo. That is what usually happens. He lost his firstborn, and all the firstborns of the people in Egypt were lost. Why? Because of this man's peacock approach, arrogance to the change that was already coming. A female example is Athaliah in the Bible. Athaliah was a peacock as well. She refused to face the fact that she would no longer be queen. She instead made up her mind that she was going to be queen mother. She murdered all the grandsons in the palace just to be. No wonder she ended up terribly and badly. You know, rather than accept the change, this woman, she destroyed all the grandchildren. And what happened? In fact, it was, she was eaten up because they flung her down from the palace because she refused to face the reality that change had come. Haman is another peacock example who had that syndrome. It was becoming obvious that, hey, Mordecai, God even used the opportunity that, look, this Mordecai that you're trying to do something with is the one that the king honored, dressed him up. And when he got home, hey, his wife told him that this one that that the king has begun to honor, you may not be able to handle, but a man as a peacock refused to face that reality until he ended up in the gallows. The Bible tells us in Isaiah chapter 44, verse 18, Isaiah 44, 18, he said, such stupidity and ignorance. He said their eyes are closed and they cannot see. Their minds are shut and they cannot think. That is the peacock syndrome. It is therefore no surprise whether it is Pharaoh, Athaliah, Haman, they all died disgracefully. Why? Because of their proud reaction and resistance to change. Again, I pray for you and I pray for me that we will never ever fall victim of being peacocks to the changes that God is bringing, that we will embrace change and adapt positively to change, trusting God to help us navigate that change. We want to look at posture number three, the late adopters. Late adopters. Late adopters are those who are slow to adapt to change. Ultimately, when they observe that, you know what, majority of people are towing the line, they will just join the process. An example of such a person is Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus was observing, there's a new man in town. Oh, people are following this man. Oh, he was a bit embarrassed. Why? Because of his status. But then what did he do? He climbed the sycamore tree. Let me see what is happening here. If everybody is going in this direction, there might be something there. So even though he initially resisted change, he witnessed the transformation of Jesus' teachings. Therefore, what did he do? He quickly embraced the new path, and Jesus followed him home, okay? And his whole entire family got saved. The same thing happened to the thief on the cross. At the last minute, looking at Jesus, see this man, everybody say, please remember me when you get. So that's a late adopter. And yet, right there on the cross, Jesus assured him of his own salvation. So, we must always, adapt to change. Whether fast, slow is better to adapt to change. King Agrippa was a late adopter. He declared in Acts chapter 26 and verse 28. Then Agrippa said unto Paul, almost thou did what? Persuadest me to be a Christian. The Lord will help us in the mighty name of Jesus. Let's quickly look at posture number four, the early adopters. The early adopters are the ones, they are distinguished in their ability because they keenly observe changing times and realities. We can see the story of Naomi. We can see the story of Ruth because they have a good understanding. Despite the pain that change might bring, despite what appeared to be an initial demotion, they joined quickly and ultimately their demotion became a promotion. Now, these early adopters, they are the ones that show resilience. They show resilience. The Bible says in Romans 8:28, and we know that all things work together for good to them that love God and who are the called according to his purpose. So when you know that whether it's good that is coming, bad is coming, God is going to work everything out for you, then you become what? An early adopter. So we look at change posture number five quickly. Change posture number five, they are the innovators. You know, these people, they are characterized by their ability to define change. Many a times, they are the ones that bring about change. Who is a good example in the Bible? Deborah is an innovator. She did not hesitate as the first female to go to war. She said, oh yeah, we are headed there. Judges chapter 5, verse 7. The inhabitants of the village ceased. They ceased in Israel until that I, Deborah, arose. That I arose a mother in Israel. The daughters of Zelophehad as well. They were very quick to go to Moses and say, is it our father's fault that he did not have a male? And because of them, the entire law about inheritance, they were able to make that change. You can also see Joseph as an innovator. He was a visionary. He saw dreams, he interpreted dreams, he went beyond the interpreting of dreams to say, this is what we are going to do because of a season that is coming. So, my brothers, my sisters, in today's episode, we have been able to look at, number one, what is called change. Number two, we have been able to look at change postures. You know, I want to leave you with this quote by Les Brown. He says, our ability to handle life's challenges is a measure of our strength and our character. And I want to trust that you and I will be positive embracers. We should embrace change no matter what it looks like. And God, in his infinite mercy, will grant each and every one of us the courage and the resilience to stand in the face of change so that at the end, God himself will be glorified. Now, if today's episode has been a blessing to you, we would love to hear your testimonies. Please share them with us on thewatchwithwonu@gmail.com. I repeat that, thewatchwithwonu@gmail.com. We also look forward to welcoming prayer partners, sponsors, mentors. They are the ones that help us with all our teaming callers. And if you are interested, please send us a WhatsApp message on +234 812 402-0538, +234 812 402-0538. Meanwhile, I'd like to invite you again to join us next week in the concluding episode of Embracing Change. Till I come your way again next week, this is Wonola Adetayo, the Shaper. And I say to you, Shalom.